All rise. The Honorable Supreme Court of Georgia is now in session. Chief Justice Carol Hunstein presiding. You may be seated.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to recognize our security for this morning, Chief Corporal Cumberson and Trooper Chris Lewis. I want to advise everyone to turn off your cell phones. If your cell phones should go off during the session, you can find yourself with a substantial problem. Madam Clerk, are there any requests for admissions this morning?
Yes, Your Honor. The following named applicants have properly certified applications, and I respectfully move for their admission to the bar of the Supreme Court.
If your name is called, will you please come inside the rail and stand in front of the podium to be sworn in?
Kaitlyn Dalton, Stephanie Dixon, Jess Johnson, James Zimmerman.
Sustaining the rule of law is the responsibility and obligation of every citizen. But courts and lawyers, I have always believed, are specially appointed to that task. Throughout the history of the Republic, we find instances in which our government has sought to limit or diminish the most fundamental liberties of the people. And what stood in their way? An independent judiciary and an independent bar, standing as a bulwark against tyranny, a last line of defense for the liberties of the people. Now, when courts and lawyers stand post against measures that, in many cases, have the support of a great many of the people, their stand often proves to be an unpopular. Our judicial system, at the same time, is deliberately, by its nature and design, the weakest of the co-equal branches of government. As Alexander Hamilton put it in Federalist 78, the executive dispenses the honors and holds the sword of the community. The legislature commands the purse and prescribes the rules by which the duties and rights of every citizen are to be regulated. The judiciary has no influence over either the sword or the purse. It may truly be said to have neither force nor will, but merely judgment. And for its judgments to have any effect, those judgments have to have the confidence of the people. The reason that our judiciary has long weathered the storms that come along with standing your post against popular measures that are nonetheless unconstitutional is because its judgment traditionally has had the confidence. Even when they haven't liked the judgment of the judiciary, people respect it. The loss of confidence in our courts and loss of trust in our lawyers threatens to undermine respect for the judgment of the judiciary. That in turn threatens our shared commitment to the rule of law. For this reason, we owe it not only to ourselves, but more important, to the Republic, to endeavor to preserve public confidence in our work. And that endeavor requires each of us to do his part. As courts, we must carry on with humility, sobriety, dignity. We must take care to always limit the judicial power to its proper scope, and we must make every effort to avoid the appearance of bias and caprice in our decision-making. As for lawyers, you must exercise the powers and privileges of your office responsibly, with a due regard for the adversaries of your clients and for third parties alike, and with the courtesy and respect due your brothers and sisters at the bar. And we all must endeavor to live our lives, not only as judges and lawyers, but as ordinary citizens, in a manner that reflects well upon the profession, keeping in mind that the people, with a capital P, always are watching. The stakes are too high to do otherwise, for upon our efforts, the rule of law depends. This is, of course, a weighty burden, which you do not bear it alone. You bear it together with your brothers and sisters at the bar. When you find yourself in need of help or advice in the practice of law, call on them. They're generous both with their resources and their time, and I know they stand ready to help. And by your association and fellowship with them, I expect you will find great personal satisfaction and fulfillment. To conclude, I again welcome you to the bar of our court. My colleagues and I wish you the very best in the practice of law and in life. At this time, I'll ask you to exit the court with our clerk. We'll ask you to tender a nominal sum as the required fee for your admission to the bar. Upon tendering that sum, you'll be given a certificate reflecting your admission, a certificate that my predecessor, former Chief Justice George Carlin, used to say is suitable for framing and posting in some prominent place. Thank you. Good luck.
Here is Hines, is not on the bench this morning.